What is your name?
My name is Mel.
Mel? Okay, why don't you email, why don't you email me, Kish, K-I-S-H.
Oh, no, he, actually, I have Mel's, he has my information. He was
I'm just saying, if the person that talked to the FBI could get a hold of Doug, and then Doug can pass his information to me is what I'm asking.
Okay.
But I don't put my number outside like that.
All right. Okay, does anybody...
I got to run off, too. But all,
right.
All I wanted to say, I don't want to have a witch hunt with Fred and Nina, but I would say, if it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it must be a duck. A lot of what's happening is just is wrong if you take advantage and hurt people, and it sure looks like that's what's happening. Now, anybody that's really interested in about seeing success, Jack and Margie has everything on the internet. I think it's takeyourlifeback.com, or Doug, you can put it out there, ask what it is. Those people have been doing it for, I think, 40 or 50 years now. And so I think a lot of stuff you hear about from Fred, he's probably been, and even the stuff that he did, would probably plagiarize off of Jack and Margie's website. But like Paul was saying, you know, when you hurt people that are on their last dime, that's just sad that you would do that. Now, if you really were helping people out, hey, you should be paid your wages, so to speak. But so many people, including myself, I'm in bankruptcy now because of this. Nobody helped me. But, I mean, actually, I want to let you know this. I've been coming across ways of forcing the hand to there's things that are coming out there right now that are, there's a Seabright case that just came, Judge Seabright just made a rule in the Ninth Circuit. And it's along the lines of securitized auditing. It's also along the lines of showing the proof of claim of the actual original note. But I mean, I'm still getting into it and learning these things. But if anything, I got into this. So folks, you gotta make this a lifelong journey. And there's a lot of things coming down our way that we're not gonna want. So I think we just gotta stick together. And I think Fred and Mish led people down what seemingly was good, but what looks good and what is God is one hole missing. Anyway, folks, I gotta go.
All right, thank you for sharing. Who else would like to step up now and share their story?
Hi, Ted. This is Joanne. I can share mine.
Hi, Joanne. Yes, Joanne, we remember you. You were on one of my first calls with Fred, and you're the one that brought up the fact that you paid some money and never heard from him or something of that nature. So go ahead. Please tell your story.
Okay. Fred and Nina were referred to me by a friend in Vegas, and it was someone I trusted. So, I contacted them, and they said they'd be glad to come up. I'm in northern Nevada, and we had a group of about 30 people. And my story is not nearly as dramatic as the ones I've heard. But what happened with me is after hearing him speak, I told him that I was a widow and that I wasn't comfortable with the EFT process and doing it myself or anything. And Nina stopped and said, well, they'd be glad to do it for me. And I felt real blessed in that, you know, here they were, the supposed experts and going to do it. And I had a couple issues, but it wasn't pressing. And so I also gave them $450. And that was for a non-government ID, and it was something that, and it wasn't pressing, and I'm not someone that bugs people or, you know, demands their time or that sort of a thing, so I waited a few months and then contacted them. When I called and talked to Fred, and I don't know how he does things now, but at that time, you would call his cell phone, and he would answer or not answer, depending on his availability. So when I called, he answered, and he said, by coincidence, they were working on my paperwork as I spoke. And so he said, you know, call back in a couple or 3 days, and it would be ready. From that point on, my phone calls were not answered, and I never heard from Fred or Nina again. So my issue is not that, I was taken for thousands of dollars or anything like that. I just chalked it up as my own mistake for believing in somebody. But my concern is that people can be hurt. And there's a lot, like you said, a lot of people out there that are desperate right now, and they're the ones that can get preyed on easily. So that's my story, and I hope it saves somebody from giving them any money. Thanks, Dad.
Thank you, Joanne.
I'm Sandy, and I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, Sandy. Please go ahead.
Hi, Joanne. I was the individual that Fred denied ever knowing, and yet I held several meetings at my house, and him and Nina even spent the night here at my home. I live in Riverside, California, and I gave him some money, $500 for the ID as well, and got the runaround on that for quite a while. Other individuals in the group also gave money for the ID. I felt responsible for the group of people because none of them could get a hold of Fred or Nina, and so I would be the one to call Fred, and of course he was always too busy, always getting ready to catch a flight, going out to the East Coast or to Hawaii. They were working on another business besides this business. They also had asked me about putting $600 on a credit card. And when I did give them permission for that, with the understanding that it would be paid the following month, they went ahead and charged $1,800 instead of $600. And so I called them on numerous occasions regarding the card. And after they had paid it, it took them about 3-4 months to pay it. Then I got the M.O. from Fred that I was incompetent and who knows what else, that I didn't understand anything that he had said, apart from all the other individuals, that they were also idiots and whatnot. So right after he told me off, he never answered another call, and it was just difficult to get a hold of him. I did call their 800 number. The daughter would answer on occasion. One occasion, the daughter said that Nina wasn't there, and yet I heard Nina speaking. And then Nina said, well, tell her I'll call her later. And then I said, well, let me speak to your father. Well, he's busy right now. He's on the other computer. And then I hung up, and I got a phone call from Nina concerning my ID, that they never received my fax. I used a different name on the ID, and they had a notary public there in Nevada swear that I was present with that name. And they did that to a couple of other individuals in my group, even though we were not there. So I've never used the ID or any credit card affiliated to it. So it was just a lot of running around, trying to get them, not being able to, making excuses for them, for the other members in the group. It's just very difficult, very, very difficult to deal with. They would also talk to me, or Fred would, about his personal married life with Nina and try to gain my sympathy to maybe perhaps be somewhat involved with him to a degree, which I never responded to. So I didn't care for that lack of integrity on that level. But that's my personal experience with them.
Tab, this is Joanne again.
Hi,
Sandy,
Joanne.
Is flight attendant, that when I confronted Fred that night on your call, he told me he didn't know a Sandy, he didn't know a flight attendant, he called me a liar.
Oh, okay.
And so that's why I asked her please to stick with you. I forgot to put that part in.
By the way, Joanne, I believe you had another experience that you told me about. Would you feel comfortable discussing that?
I don't remember what it was, but I think I said enough.
Okay.
Just that that night when I confronted him on your call, he called me a liar. He said he didn't know the people that I was referring to. And
I think there were some people that were wanting to talk to you.
Oh, no, that wasn't me. You're thinking
of Laurel.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, oh, okay. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
That's okay. That's okay. Thank you.
Okay. I'm sorry, Sandy. Go ahead.
Oh, and I had a friend who is a personal detective friend of mine, and he was doing some research to find out their whereabouts. And he did some computer work and there were several P.O. boxes in their names from different years, Nina seemed to have come up with different social security numbers within her age group, or rather her precise age and the year she was born. They would never give their whereabouts, where they lived or what street or an address or any other phone numbers to further contact them. Once they cut you out of their circle or out of their life, it's impossible to get a hold of them and to reach them. And with some detective work that my friend did, he saw how difficult it was, and said, "This is the con artists. This is what they do for a living. They hide from individuals, very hard to find. I could further the research," he said, "but I'm just letting you know what I'm finding from these individuals." So it's I stopped the process about a year ago. I haven't spoken to Fred or Nina about a little over a year.
Wow, okay. Well, thank you for sharing that. Is there anything else you wanted to share?
No, I think that's it.
Okay.
Because I wrote it on here. It's got to be typed in.
Hey, Chad?
Yes.
Oh.
Hi, it's yes. Mish.
Hi, Mish. Please, go ahead.
I know you wanted to talk about the EFT, so I have a case number here in Hawaii where the EFT was actually brought up in the courtroom.
Okay.
And the judge just totally ignored it. And the case number out here in Hawaii is civil number 10121180. And a little bit more about that case, which is the case that I'm helping with right now. Interesting enough, the lawyers here have a copy of a grant deed that was notarized in the state of California, San Bernardino. And the two homeowners' names that are on this document that this notary, you know how this goes, you have to be sitting in front of the notary.
Uh-huh.
These two homeowners never left this island for the past 7 years.
So what you're saying is that there is a grant deed as though they granted property to somebody, and they signed this grant deed in front of a notary in California, but what you're saying is that they never left the island, so they could not be in California. Is that what you're saying?
That's correct.
Okay.
And this is, I can talk about this one because I'm actually working with this homeowner. And regarding the EFTs, out of all the EFTs that I've written and helped people with, two people got their titles for their cars. And after dealing with Honda wanting to speak with either me or my husband, because that's who the instrument was used from, I immediately just told the homeowner, go get the the lien released from the DMV. They did that. And 2 months later, no letters whatsoever. No one's bothering them with their cars yet. But there are others that I wrote EFTs for who have not only gone to court, but their checks are all being garnished right now. And I wish they could have been on the call. And then one in particular that I did want to talk about was this visit by the FBI. So if you do get visited by the FBI, they're really not wanting to talk to us, little fish. They're trying to get to the bigger fish. So we talked to them about the EFT, and, you know, just know before you start writing an EFT what you're actually doing, because